All right, hello everyone, Simon here, and welcome back to our ARCHMINE 100 series where we are learning architectural concepts through Minecraft. So in the sixth lecture today, we're going to talk about landscape. Landscape is, at least in terms of kind of architecture and design, it means designed land. So landscape, the scape part of landscape emphasizes the shape of the land. So scape means the shape. So the shape of the land, but also the shaping of the land in terms of kind of changing the land into something that you like. The picture here is of the Taj Mahal garden in India. The Taj Mahal is pretty famous, but the garden, usually you see pictures of the building itself, the kind of the white mausoleum. But the gardens are also very well designed. Here's a picture of a part of it there. So I mean, sometimes people consider the landscape to be like the opposite of architecture, whereas architecture is buildings, the landscape is all the other stuff. You know, all the stuff outside the building is landscaping. But it's not really, you know, they're not really opposites, because when you kind of move through spaces, you kind of move from indoors to outdoors, nothing really changes. Like, you know, and designing outdoors is pretty much the same thing as designing indoors. Like, the same concepts apply. The things we talked about so far, things like scale and color and form and movement and light and so on, these things apply to exteriors as well as interiors. So in terms of the skills you learn as an architect, most of them can be applied to the landscape as well. There are some of them are different, but most of the design concepts you can apply both to landscapes and to buildings. Landscaping, for the most part, when we talk about especially gardens, they're not entirely natural. This picture is an illustration of the Garden of Eden, or what somebody imagines the Garden of Eden to be. Gardens and parks are built to satisfy people's desire for more accessible nature. Things like fresh air, sunlight, greenery, exercise, maybe animals. So when you go to a garden, you like plants. You know, you want plants and flowers, maybe you want the sun. But, you know, there are a lot of things in nature that you don't want. Things like bear attacks, or poisonous snakes, or scorpions, you know, or sharks. You don't want those things. Or you don't want to be in a blizzard, right? So when you talk about a garden, usually a garden excludes the things you don't want. Like if you get attacked by a bear in a garden, that's not really a good garden. So, you know, despite the landscapes, or despite kind of these parks and gardens sometimes appearing to be quite natural, or people might say, well, let's get in touch with nature and go to a park, or something like that. Despite, you know, the feel of kind of being close to trees and flowers and then fresh air, landscapes that are designed for human recreation are actually very carefully controlled, and that, you know, you provide certain aspects of nature, but not others. So it's not really wild nature. In this painting here, like, you know, the lions are just kind of sitting there, being nice to each other, and they're not actually attacking the animals, right? That makes no sense at all, really. And like the fox is just kind of ignoring all the other animals, and everything seems to be so peaceful. So I mean, in this kind of imaginary idea of a Garden of Eden, you know, the Garden of Paradise, is that for some weird reason everything is happy, but that's not how nature is, you know? Gardens are also often objects of desire, in the sense that people make landscapes into what they want. Like, you know, if you build a garden, like, what are you doing? Like, why are you changing the land? Like, why are you shaping the land? Because you want it to be different, because you want to improve it. I mean, people usually don't change the land to make it worse deliberately. So gardens are objects of desire because you are kind of making a place that you want. As we said earlier, like, you exclude the things that you don't want. You exclude the bear attacks and the poisonous snakes and so on and so forth. So here, this picture is an imaginary rendition of the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. This is a 16th century engraving. According to the stories, it was built by the King Nebuchadnezzar II for his wife, Amethyst, in the desert city of Babylon. So her wife came from an area where there are lush mountains, so kind of mountains and trees and water. But she married Nebuchadnezzar II and moved to the desert city of Babylon and was not impressed by all the sand and desert. And so according to the story, the king built the hanging gardens for her because it's, to kind of remind her of her home, where there's these kind of pavilions and plants everywhere and trees and flowers. Although this is from literary sources only, there's no actual archaeological remains for the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. So people talk about it, but no ruins have been found to date that we can be sure about. So whether this thing actually existed, we don't know, but that's the story. The story still, nevertheless, is kind of interesting because, you know, the wife wanted a certain kind of landscape that was like her home, and so the king made it for her out of something, you know, out of the desert. Like he kind of built a mountain in the desert for her because she wanted it. So that's what we mean when we say objects of desire. Like you kind of you make a garden that looks like what you want. And, you know, more than architecture, we do this with landscape, because architecture, a lot of it is functional, a lot of it is very practical. Whereas with gardens, you know, in order for it to kind of qualify as a garden, or rather, you know, we judge our gardens based on how much they satisfy our desires for a certain kind of nature. Let's put it that way. So, moving on to different types of garden design, this is a picture of the Versailles Gardens in France, and it's a pretty good example of the French formal garden, which is typically highly geometric, with a lot of straight lines, regular polygons, and symmetry. So you can see in the map here, like all the paths are very straight, and you get this kind of symmetrical man-made lake, and then there's some geometrical patterns in the gardens as well. So the idea here is the imposition of order over nature. So nature is, you know, wild and chaotic, and so you kind of put these straight lines over the landscape, and that kind of it represents the order and rationality. There's also an expression of power and control. Versailles was the palace of the King of France. And so these lines radiating outwards from his palace represented the projection of his power and his rule. So, you know, the lines imposing this kind of order onto nature is representative of the king's power imposing order on the country. So there's the ideas behind, like, why do you put straight lines in the ground? It's because this idea of, you know, taking something that's chaotic and making it orderly. So that's the kind of the underlying ideas behind the French formal garden. So just keep that in mind. This is a photo of a part of it. You can see how, you know, you have kind of potted trees arranged into kind of circles and squares, and then you have the lawn with these interesting shapes in them. So everything's very geometric. And nothing's particularly natural, because like everything's in straight lines and everything. So, and, you know, the perfectly circular fountain and pond, and all these kind of geometric shapes. And if you compare, like, you know, the garden in front with the trees in the background, like, that's wilderness. You know, out in the distance, in the horizon, that's wilderness. And whereas here, there's order. So there's really this desire to create order and to create something that is predictable out of the chaos of nature. Wrong way. So, in contrast, this is a map of Central Park in 1875. And Central Park is in New York. So this is one example of an English landscape garden. And the landscape garden is designed to appear naturalistic. So it's like the exact opposite of the French formal garden. And in order to make it appear naturalistic, there's a lot of curving paths, irregular shapes, and asymmetry. So if you can see the plan here, like if you know New York, you'll know that the city is a very, very rigid grid, at least on Manhattan Island. There's a very rigid grid that goes across Manhattan Island. And in the middle of Manhattan Island is this park. And so, you know, already there's a lot of order and structure on Manhattan. And so there's really no point having more structure and more order in the garden. So remember that gardens are objects of desire. And so when you're surrounded by this rigid grid, what you desire is what you don't have. And what you don't have is this kind of natural curving shapes. And so then with the Central Park here, you can see how all the lakes are, or most of the lake, there's a bit of square. There's a square in the reservoir in the middle, but most of the parts are kind of curving. Most of the water areas are kind of irregular shapes. And if you kind of walk through one of these English landscape gardens, a lot of the parts of the park are arranged so that you discover them. As you kind of walk through the park, you kind of discover one part after the other. And the paths are arranged so that, you know, you kind of, you come across, maybe you go around a tree and you find a view, or you come over a mountain, but you come over a hill and you find a view, or find a nice pleasant glade or something. And so it works with movements and exploration and discovery to create this kind of a sequence of events that are kind of pleasant and wondrous. And as I said, the Central Park's curving lines offer some relief from the rigid grid of New York. And so, you know, as an example of a park of, or as a part of the Central Park, this is this great lawn in Central Park. So as you kind of look at this picture, everything appears very naturalistic, right? Even though it's actually very carefully designed. Like somebody carefully planted all the trees and carefully shaped the lake and everything else. But it appears natural, like it appears naturalistic at least. Right, there's no straight lines that you can see, except in the background in the buildings. So again, you know, you contrast, you know, whereas before with Versailles, the surrounding area is this kind of wild forest. So you create a contrasting thing in your garden, which is full of straight lines. Whereas in New York, the surrounding area is this all these buildings and straight streets. And so then you create a contrasting thing with this naturalistic park. So again, the idea of this object of desires, of kind of wanting things that you don't have, and so you put those things in your garden so you can have the things that you don't have. Going back to this, again, to the Hanging Gardens of Babylon, why do you build a mountain in the desert? Because there's no mountains in the desert and you want a mountain. So there's always this wanting things that you don't have, and therefore you put it in a garden. So that's a very common theme in a lot of gardens and landscape design. Moving on to other cultures, the Islamic garden originated in the hot, arid climates of the Middle East, and because of that, it led to the use of fountains and shade. So what fountains do is that it sprays water into the air and it humidifies the air and it reduces the air temperature around the fountain. And, you know, shade obviously provides shelter from the sun. So because, you know, the Islamic garden originated in kind of desert areas, or at least arid and hot, dry areas, so, you know, the use of fountains and shading trees became very common. And also many gardens were built into courtyards, so you have your building with an open area in the middle and then like fountains and gardens in the middle. And what that does is that the building provides shelter for the garden from hot winds. So, you know, the walls surrounding the garden kind of protects it from the winds. And then the fountains in the courtyard humidify the air for the surrounding buildings so that the temperature in the surrounding buildings are not as hot as outside. So the building and the courtyard garden kind of works together to regulate the local climate to make it slightly more pleasant to live in. And of course, again, the object of desire, because you're in a desert environment, you know, greenery and water and trees are rather rare sometimes. And so then you kind of put these things in your garden again, so you see a lot of green leaves and flowers and water everywhere. And there's also sometimes use of intricate tessellating geometric patterns as seen in Islamic architecture. That's just a carryover from, have I said this before? In the Quran forbids the worship of idols. I guess the Bible does too, but the way the Quran interprets that is that you're not supposed to worship even images of Jesus or Muhammad or God. So there's no statues of people, there's no paintings of people in Islamic art. Well, not in Islamic art. In Islamic religious art, there's no kind of paintings of people, because that would be worshipping the icon instead of worshipping the actual, you know, God. So over time, in Islamic architecture, they kind of, instead of kind of putting in pictures of things, they put in abstract patterns, abstract geometric and mathematical patterns into the buildings, because they need to decorate the buildings somehow, and if you can't use pictures of people, then you just kind of make these patterns, right? So there's a lot of interesting patterns in Islamic architecture because of that, and sometimes it carries over into their gardens. Here, this is a courtyard in Alhambra in Spain, and you can see the squares, and there's a little bit of geometry there, but not too much. In China, Chinese gardens are a different concept again. The Chinese philosophy and culture has certain ideals of harmony and contemplation and mystery, and so there's a lot of stories about how people just spend a lot of time thinking. So there's a lot of thinking involved in kind of in Chinese philosophy. And what Chinese gardens do is they present moments of ideal scenery as may be found in Chinese landscape paintings. So, you know, from certain positions within the Chinese garden, you can just kind of look out, and like this here, in this image here, like, you know, there's kind of water in front, and then there's like a pavilion nestled inside the trees, and then there's this kind of rock area, and then there's a little bridge hidden behind the leaves. And so it looks kind of like a painting. It looks like a Chinese landscape painting. And so the Chinese garden is a recreation of these kind of ideal bits from their, you know, their artistic tradition. The architectural elements are often used as, you know, and they're also used in a way that incorporates them into the landscape. You know, the architecture might frame a scene, or it might serve as a focal element. So the buildings, you know, they're often like this we see here, like they're often nestled into the plants and the vegetation, whereas, you know, if you look back at, you know, the French gardens or the English gardens, there's no real buildings inside the garden itself, whereas the Chinese kind of incorporate these kind of architectural elements in the gardens. It's not shown here, but one kind of concept behind the Chinese garden is that you only ever get a partial view of, you know, one part of the garden. You never see the whole thing at once. Unlike Versailles, unlike Versailles, where you might kind of, actually, I don't know if you can see it here, but the palace is to the right. And if you kind of look out from the balcony of the palace, you can kind of just see the whole garden laid out before you. So the Chinese don't do that. The Chinese only ever allow you to see a part of it. And so as you kind of walk through a Chinese garden, you get moments. You get kind of these kind of perfect moments, one after the other, but you never see the whole thing. And again, that's part of the idea of kind of contemplation and mystery, the idea that you never really see the whole, you know, you never get to see the whole thing at once. You have to kind of think about all the different parts if you want to understand the whole. So, you know, this is kind of interesting intersection between Chinese philosophy and Chinese gardens, right? So, moving on to Japanese gardens. Similar to the Chinese tradition, but notable for their use of abstraction and their pursuit of naturalness. And when I say naturalist here, not necessarily natural, but things that appear natural, which is not quite the same as things that are actually natural. So first of all, the abstraction. In Zen gardens, as an example, you'll find arrangements where there's rocks, like Zen rock gardens, where rocks represent mountains, and they would be set in gravel. And the gravel represents water and waves. So in this picture here, this is a rock garden. So you see the abstraction going on. The gravel is an abstract representation of water. I mean, they could have just put real water there, but they don't. They put the gravel there. And the rocks are kind of abstractions of mountains. And so it represents a kind of like a scene, but it's they don't actually use real mountains and real water. They kind of use these kind of symbolic representations of them. The rocks here, they're chosen for their weathering character and interesting shapes. So they don't just take any rock. They actually kind of pick rocks that really, really look like rocks. And they do the same thing to trees as well. So they don't just let the trees grow by themselves. Like, trees are often carefully pruned and carefully shaped over many years to appear very natural. Or they like to appear like perfect trees, perfectly natural trees, when in fact they're very carefully cultivated. So the Japanese have this kind of this interest in perfection, I guess, and this interest in making things appear perfect and making things appear natural, but at the same time putting in a lot of work to make it appear natural. And one example, I guess, is the bonsai trees, where it's just a miniaturized tree in a pot. It's a pot plant, but you know, there's so much skill and time and investment into making that little pot plant look like a really old natural tree, but it's not. Like, it's a miniaturized, so it's abstracted. It's a miniaturized version of something that appears really natural, but in reality, somebody spent a lot of time cultivating that thing. So the Japanese does this, which is, you know, again, very interesting, and probably reflects their cultural values. We should probably talk a little bit about the intersection of landscape and buildings. So this is an example of a sod roof from Norway. So buildings usually sit on the landscape, but sometimes the landscape sits on the buildings. So a sod roof is basically soil with grass on top growing on the building. And this is actually quite practical. What happens here is that the soil and the grass provides insulation for the house, and it also is weight holding down the structure. So it actually kind of, it's insulation for the house, and it holds the roof down. And it also packs the logs underneath as well, because the weight of the soil keeps the logs kind of close together and kind of held down. Whereas if the roof is too light, then because timber shrinks and expands depending on the moisture level, and as the timber moves, you get gaps in the logs, and then you get kind of wind and water coming in the gaps. That's not very good. So the soil actually helps to pack the logs down together, so it kind of reduces the gaps in the walls in this kind of log cabin. Underneath the soil is a layer of birch bark that provides the waterproofing. So, you know, because it's soil, you know, if there's no waterproofing, then the water just kind of comes through the soil. So this kind of sod roof, it works pretty well. And the great thing is that it's literally just dirt. You know, you just literally dig up the dirt from next to the house, put it on the roof, and that's your building material. So it's abundant and renewable, and you literally just pick it up off the ground and put it on your roof, and it works. So it's pretty great, this sort of arrangement. Very environmentally friendly, right? More modern building. This is the City Hall in Chicago. These days, green roofs are becoming more common, and there are a lot of benefits to having green roofs. A green roof is basically putting plants on your roof. And what happens with putting these on modern buildings is, again, it provides insulation against solar heat gain. So, you know, as the sun kind of shines on your building, it gets hot. But, you know, having the plants there and having the plants kind of evapotranspire, which is, you know, they breathe air, and they also kind of release moisture into the air as they breathe. And that reduces the amount of heat that goes into the building, and then that often helps you know, reducing the need for air conditioning on the inside. The plants and the little bit of soil also helps slow down rainwater runoff. So when it rains, usually the water just sheets off the roof and then goes into your gutters. But if there's a bit of vegetation there, then it actually slows down how quickly the water runs off, and it helps with the rainwater regulation as well. So there's a lot of benefits to having green roofs, and some American cities, I think New York in particular, has subsidies for green roofs. So if you kind of put a garden on the top of your building, I think you get a tax break or something. But a number of cities have this, and it does help the city quite a bit, because, you know, there's not much vegetation in the middle of cities, and every little bit can help, and every little bit improves the quality of the air and the temperature regulation in the city. The downside is that you need a slightly stronger structure to hold up the soil, because soil is heavy, especially after it rains and it's soaked in the water. It's a bit heavier than your typical roof. So if you want to have a garden on top of your building, you need to have a big enough structure underneath to hold it up. It's not a big deal, but it does represent a bit more cost up front. But there are benefits over time, so I think it's worth it to put kind of gardens on your buildings. This is a more recent invention. This is a green wall, where literally you put plants on a wall. It's technologically challenging. What you need is a substrate on which the vegetation can grow. If you can imagine, you can do it a number of ways. Like, you can pack earth together and maybe put them into sacks, and then put the plants and have the plants grow through the fabric, and they kind of root in the soil and grow outwards. You can do it that way, or you can use kind of other substrates. But the main issue is that you have to provide water to the plants, and you have to provide nutrients to the plants. And you probably should also select plants that are happy to grow vertically. Not all plants are happy to do this, but some plants are. And if you can kind of get it right, you can get gardens to grow vertically like this, as long as you kind of keep providing water to it. And the great thing about this is that it takes up no floor space, because it's literally vertical. Because, you know, floor space becomes very expensive in cities, and so, you know, people don't want to spend money on a garden when they can, you know, put an office there or a house there or something, right? So the vertical garden saves space while still providing vegetation in the city, which is pretty good. But it's kind of complicated, it's technically challenging, and you do need kind of special skills to maintain this thing, because, you know, over time the substrate will get worn out, because there's literally plants growing in it. So you kind of have to replace the substrate or you know, fix it every now and then. So it does require some maintenance, but, you know, in areas where floor area is very expensive, this becomes, you know, economically feasible. All right, so that's it for landscaping. For the exercise, number 6, you are to build a city park. So on the island next to the city there on the left, you are to design and build a city park. Note that the site is much larger than the previous exercises. You don't necessarily have to use the whole site, but it's much bigger, so just kind of think about how much time you want to spend on this. Take the time to walk around the island and see if there's anything you'd like to keep. So look around, see what's there already, and then think about how you want to change it and what you want to do with it. Consider adopting one of the landscaping styles discussed previously, or another one you can research. So, you know, we talked about the French formal garden, we talked about English landscape gardens, we talked about Islamic gardens, we talked about Chinese gardens, we talked about Japanese gardens. And there are other, you know, ways to design as well, and if you want to do some research, you can look these things up and learn about them. So consider using one of these styles, or maybe a mixture of features from a few of these styles. So maybe you want to do like a French formal garden, and just kind of put straight lines everywhere. Like, if you have a theme or have an idea, then it becomes easier to design. In addition to just the island itself, consider the relationship to the city also. So consider the relationship between the city and the garden. So if you're in the city, what do you see? Like, when you look across the river, for example, and you see the garden, maybe consider how how that looks. And of course, the other way around, if you're in the garden looking towards the city, you know, you might want to consider how that looks as well. It's difficult to kind of talk in detail without actually doing the thing on the ground. But, you know, as you're there, just kind of look around the island and just kind of see what you can see. You know, just kind of, we're talking about kind of putting in maybe pavilions or trees in places so that you get views out into the city, maybe. So it's stuff like that. I'll talk about this in more detail, of course, in the next video as we, as I kind of have a go at the exercise myself. Here are the image licenses, and that's the end of this lecture. It was a very, very brief overview of some very, very complicated topics. Like, I don't want to, you know, spend hours and hours and hours talking about landscape, but you can. Like, if you care about it, you can. There's a lot of things for you to learn. But I think the best thing to do, since we're playing Minecraft, is just to try it out and see what happens. So I'll see you guys in the next video where we experiment with landscaping.